And debrief the Organizational Behavior Teaching Conference to talk about the things that we think went especially well, to talk about things we wish we had done differently, and perhaps to give some advice to future conference hosts. Georgia, Nikki, Bob, all three of you were very much involved in volunteer work with the conference and actively involved in the days that the conference was actually running as well as in pre-planning. So I'm looking for your help with ideas and suggestions and, mm-hmm. and making an archival record here of what really happened. For me, I think one of the things that made this conference was so special was that this particular conference seemed like an especially good match to the kind of university this is and the kind of campus we have. Laverne's focus on teaching, the society's focus on mm-hmm. teaching, the compact size of our campus, and the friendly and supportive spirit of all kinds of people. I actually counted at one time that some 55 people were at work every minute making mm-hmm. the conference happen. Mm-hmm. But I'd like to hear some of your ideas, too, about what you think helped to make it so successful.
Starting early. Early planning. Very mm-hmm. early. Mm-hmm. And a lot of things that we had, such as bags and mugs, were done a month before the conference started. Mm-hmm.
Yes,
so we didn't have to worry about those situations. They were done.
The design for the conference program cover, for instance, was done, I think, by February. Mm-hmm. Whatever we could get done in advance, we tried to get done in advance.
Right.
Yeah. I think just the use of students, for instance, setting up the special class to give the master's students a focus to learn something about conference development and leading, as well as actually getting them physically involved throughout the conference is a real plus.
Good point. And a lot of the creative ideas and special touches for the conference came out of the work of those students. We also had what we internally called the Lunch Bunch, which were faculty from neighboring campuses who came mm-hmm. and met with us three or four times and gave us advice, particularly those who had a long experience with this particular conference, mm-hmm. so we could stay in tune with its culture. That was helpful.
I thought that paying attention to the details and having a lot of the details taken care of ahead of time then allowed for the unknowns or the variables. And I find in doing things like this that that is so important, because if you have something underneath and a base and you can plan on those things, then the variables aren't going to just throw everything out of whack.
I'm glad you're there for backup. Bye.
You say it's not raining, Carol?
It is not raining. It does not rain in Southern California.
Ah, well, that's good to know.
I'm a child of the 60s. I listen to the Beach Boys. I know. It is not raining. Who's going to buy the umbrellas?
I found that a lot of those little details had been taken care of, and so that the unknowns were doable.
Here again, I think yes. we should underscore the role of the volunteers, because mm-hmm. that Saturday that we spent in training mm-hmm. the volunteers, mm-hmm. where we closed that day by painting the rock and getting all of the entrance to the university mm-hmm. ready, that was such an important day, because we, all 20 or so of us who were part of that, were brainstorming what might go wrong,
yeah.
what could happen, what do we want to have in place.
Yeah, I agree with that, but at the same time, I think we have to remember there are at least three key parts to that event planning. One was the buy-in of the administration of this university.
Mm-hmm.
If we didn't have the buy-in from
right.
the president, a lot of
right.
things just simply wouldn't have occurred.
Yeah.
Yeah, the volunteers were great, and I agree with you, but the facilities and the availability that we were able
Absolutely.
To bring to the conference through the president's efforts and through everybody's efforts.
Welcome to the University of Laverne. How many of you knew where Laverne was before this OBTC conference? Could you just raise your hand? And now you all know where the University of Laverne is. Are you sure this is a real conference? Everyone's having so much fun. Would you adopt me as an honorary organization? He's actually had us all looking forward to this moment when you would be on our campus and join us. So I want to take this opportunity to not thank Carol Sawyer and Nancy Frank for the work they've done, and all of the other people at the University of Laverne who have made this possible. My hat is off to all of you. Thank you.
And Dr. Morgan gathered all the relevant directors from across the campus, the people who deal with facilities and telephone and catering and housing and the print shop and so on, mm-hmm. everything you think of, to be sure they all understood what we hope to accomplish mm-hmm. with this conference, not right. only for the people who are coming, but also for the university.
Right.
But there are some other things, too. Nikki said earlier is we augmented the volunteers with the use of the paw prints. That was really a great idea.
Right.
That took the
right.
place of a lot of people having to direct people back and forth.
Right.
We simply gave them the path, and they were able to follow both the balloons hanging up to indicate where the facility or the classroom
mm-hmm.
was,
right.
the prints hanging around
like
the key
that.
Points.
And mm-hmm. it didn't rain too hard, so they didn't right. all wash
and
off.
And we did get our umbrellas when
right.
it rained.
The other feedback that came in was about the little box of support items in each classroom.
Mm-hmm.
Whoever came
mm-hmm.
up with that idea,
that was,
that was a great
so
idea.
Right.
Yeah. That was yeah. Something that I think every future conference will probably have
right.
to replicate. And
wonderful.
That idea came out of the one-time-only class of graduate students. So
right.
there was this plastic box in every presentation room with chalk and markers mm-hmm. and wash and dries and I mean everything you could imagine that a presenter could possibly need on a regular basis or a special case basis.
That was a great idea. I think every presenter that I talked to had a favorable comment about the box or the way they were able to use it.
We began on Monday before most of our guests showed up. We began with a board meeting that was dinner at my house, and I had such a sense of community. This is my professional community, these 17 people.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it just filled my house with joy. And I love every board meeting because to watch the skill and the professionalism and the affection with which the board members interact with each other, and then I think that spills over to the conference.
Our intricate network of norms and folkways have evolved over the years into a system that is as complex and as nuanced and as rule-driven as a Japanese tea ceremony held on the altar of a Roman Catholic church. I love this organization. I just love this place. It's like the NBA. I love this game. They're saying, I would like to welcome you to the Organizational Behavior Teaching Conference. You only need to say conference once, all right? The board has approved four ways of describing the conference. You can simply use the initials. I'm going to OBTC. You can also simply say, I'm going to the Organizational Behavior Teaching Conference. You can say, I'm going to the OBTS Conference, or the Organizational Behavior Teaching Society Conference. Or for those of you who like the more challenging, I'm going to the OBT conference, where you leave off that seat. So that's the first dealing minor issues here.
The Organizational Behavior Teaching Conference, a gathering of professors of organizational behavior and management seeking to continually improve their own excellence in the classroom. A little schmoozy note that went on top of it, too, that reminded people that whatever razzle-dazzle you build into a conference, the heart of it, the success of it, is what happens in those workshop sessions.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, especially in a conference like that, where the centerpiece were the workshops.
Yes, because and, we're learning from each other.
Right, right. And they were so crucial, and yet we really couldn't plan on everything until the last minute that went on in those workshops.
All right, let me say, there are a few things about sessions that the group, that the board wanted me to talk about. What if nobody comes to your session? That's really the basic. I'm not talking about the situation where you have like 3 or 4 people who show up. I mean, nobody comes to your session. It's just you. Maybe a custodian wanders in. You sit down, you chat, you give him a handout. He asks some pretty good questions. Now, the thing to keep in mind is that this is not an uncommon event. This is a small conference, all right? So there are not a lot of people to spread around the sessions. We have a lot of sessions. And so there are a lot of concurrent sessions. You're competing with a lot of other presenters. And let's face it, if you're doing a session on how to teach evening students to understand Broom's expectancy theory using tuna fish salad's handcrafted sculptures, and you're competing with a session in which Peter Vail teaches God how to survive in whitewater, where do you think people are going to be? Now, come on. Let's be honest. And don't blame Peter for that. All right? He has just as much right to submit a session as anybody else. So what happens when that occurs? What happens? Rule number one, don't tell anybody. Rule number two, if somebody asks you how your session went, simply say, fine. That is not a lie. I generally have found that my sessions go better when nobody comes. It is much easier to control the pace of the session. When I say to the custodian, do you have a question? They don't get into an argument. We don't have the postmodernists against the positivists. I mean, the staff simply look at me and say, hey, that makes sense. And we move on.
I think from the event that's useful is a sense of celebration that went on during the whole conference. I mean, the events that were planned, the dragons, for instance, and some of the other things, really, I think, impacted the conferees in a very positive way.
We only get one 25th anniversary. That's why we had the cake. We had two people who were there at the very first conference, 25 years ago at Stanford.
Which was so interesting to have them talk about how small it was. Yes. And how other people.
I'm video and digital and every other way, but they also want to say a couple of words about that very first conference 25 years ago.
The conference started, or the idea for the started at a dinner, or not a dinner, a lunch at a bistro in Palo Alto involving Hal Levitt, myself, Tom Harold, I think a couple other people. And we were having trouble with the introductory OB course. And Hal is really the spark that started this. And he said, I wonder if other schools are having trouble with teaching the introductory OB course, which was getting sort of minus ratings, not just even low ratings. So he said, well, gee, maybe we ought to invite some people together and talk about the intro course. And we then talked to some colleagues at Berkeley, Raymond Miles and George Strauss. And I think both of the schools threw in $2,000 for seed money, and we decided to have a conference where we invite sort of the major schools, some local schools, and also some innovative schools, including University of New Hampshire. So we sent out a letter saying, we're having some trouble with the introductory OB course. We want to have a sort of a 2-day conference at this hotel in Berkeley, the Claremont Hotel, and do you want to come? And it was sort of the notion of, what if you give a party and nobody comes? So we wondered, would anybody respond? And most of the schools responded. Wisconsin responded. I think, Andre, you were there at the time at Wisconsin. And we had 35, 40 people, faculty, who showed up. And we sat in around the table talking about the problems we were having, common approaches, difficulties, and plans for the future. But the interesting point was at the end of the conference. And we sort of looked around and said, gee, this has really been an exciting 2 days. Should we get together again? And there was a sort of silence. And somebody said, well, I guess we could. This really has been very useful. But I wonder who's going to host it? And there was an even longer silence. sort of like the notion, as we look back, that the whole future of what has happened since this 25 years hung in that 20 seconds of silence. And it was, who was it, SMU?
SMU.
But who was there? It was the,
Mick McGill.
Mick said, I think I can get the dean to do it. And as I remember, people sort of went, so it had a future. And next year we met at SMU. In fact, if you wanted, the other thing that happened is in preparation for the first conference, we had everybody write sort of 4-page position papers of their introductory course and what it was like. And they're actually in the history room if you want to read what it was like 25 years ago, the issues that we were struggling with. For the SMU conference, it was, where is OB going to be in the 80s? And those papers are there also, in terms of, in 74, 75, where do we think the world would be in the 80s? Where would OB be in the 80s? And so we had the second conference was at SMU. It was a little larger, about 40, 45.
Yeah, I think the first one was 25, the second was 40.
Oh, okay, 25, okay, 40. And then what was starting to happen is we were starting to get some flack from our colleagues at other schools who weren't being invited. Sort of, you know, who are you to, you know, have an in-group or an out-group and so on. So, oh, Alan and I, this was also, you want to tell us, sorry, the first time we met.
I was going to tell two parts of the story. One is that David has left out something that he really is responsible for. That same period when we were sitting around trying to figure out if anybody would like to do this again, David said, I think it would be helpful if we kind of put this stuff together and sent it around. Maybe we could have a newsletter or something. And again, there was a silence, and somebody said, well, yeah, you'll do it, sure. That was the birth of what's now the Journal of Management Education.
You can subscribe to the Journal of Management Education without coming to the conference. I have met a number of people over the years who hate this conference, but who love the journal. Their universities are paying them $1,000 to come here to subscribe to a $40 journal. They never go to any sessions. They sit in their rooms. They don't interact with people. They don't like most of the people here, but they love this journal. You can subscribe to the journal separately from the conference. It's a whole different deal. So please see Deanna, who's the editor, to work that out.
People were so impressed by the attitude of the volunteers and the staff, and that the service that they rendered was, how can I help you?
Yes. This is a university that gives back to its community.
Oh, I agree. We did a lot of things right as a university, as individuals here. And at the same time, for future conferences, I think there were several things that we learned collectively that we ought to talk about,
right,
because I think we can save some people putting these on in the future some grief,
sure,
that we would have liked to avoid it if we could have.
Oh, I'd like to reinforce Nikki's point about starting early. Well, we did start early on lots of parts of the conference. We could have done even more. We could have done some things 18 months out that would have made the last month that included the conference itself and the afterwards be so much easier for us.
Which you don't realize, because we really thought we started very early.
Well, and you're also juggling, virtually every conference host will also be juggling your regular responsibility of programs and classes and students. The one thing I regret the most, I think, is that we didn't do fundraising. And I'm glad to hear that next year's host has already started to seek some corporate sponsorship, because you know, it helps with the budget, it helps with the sense of the relationship between the academic world and the business community. And it lets you add some special touches to the conference.
Well, some of the printing issues that came up were a function of money that would have really been easier to handle if we'd had a little bit of working capital.
Well, and that also helps bring in the community involvement. If they're involved early on with advertising, and support, then it just sort of expands to a community, almost a community event.
We did some good things with downtown merchants, but we could have done more.
Right, right. And we did use a lot of local merchants for the bag printing and the caps, the t-shirts, things like that. So, you know, they were a part of it.
Well, this university, just the way it sets in terms of the community, lends itself to an interactive role, and that's right. We could have done a better job of that, perhaps.
Let's talk for a minute about what happened over in the registration area, because a lot of different kinds of activities were going on there with the publishers' exhibits. We brought back a tradition that this particular conference has had for years of taking the mug shots of Polaroid pictures and then stapling a business card to it so everybody could see on the coffee break who else was here. And that was fun for people, I think. And one of our talented conferees is actually taking those and drawing caricatures that probably will be a part of the future year's conference. That's fun. Mm-hmm. And we had a chance over there for tours of the campus and the town, and people wanted to take advantage of that to buy the commemorative t-shirt, the 25th anniversary t-shirt, just to mix and mingle and reconnect and network.
Yeah, the walking tours were a real good idea. The maps, I think, helped people see where they were.
Mm-hmm. Maps were very good.
Yeah.
Okay, one of the things that I think we did well was the pacing of the sessions, giving people plenty of break time between the sessions to move from one building to the other, time to sit under a tree and talk with each other and reconnect what's been happening in your life since I saw you last year. I think that was a real plus. This is a conference where people need to be with people and not be so tightly scheduled. They can't do that.
That's a real plus with a small campus, too.
Yes.
It doesn't take you so long to get from point A to point B that you can really take a little bit more time in between to talk.
A thing to remember for future conference hosts, too, is how much work there is after the guests have gone home.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't plan well to have adequate staff for all the follow-up activity mm-hmm. that has to happen. Not only the people who decide to stay over a couple of extra days, but the shipping of publishers' materials, the thank you notes, the finalizing of the budget. The work of the conference doesn't stop when you've had the closing mm-hmm. ceremony. It probably needs one and a half people 20, 30 hours a week for 3 or 4 weeks afterwards.
You know, that's an excellent point. In fact, in terms of setting up the conference, the mindset, I think, of everybody, volunteers, participants, everything else, is that on the last day, that's the last day, we all breathe a sigh of relief. And maybe in setting up the dates, there ought to be a conference date, but there also ought to be an index set at least 48 hours to maybe even 72 hours beyond that for those types of things, so that you have a volunteer crew that carries on. I think that's an excellent point.
We wanted, because it was the 25th anniversary, to be very celebratory, and celebratory on multiple dimensions, to celebrate the society and its work and its people, but also to celebrate Southern California as the host, our one chance to present ourselves to the community that is the Oral Behavior Teaching Society. So we paid attention to our cultures with the mariachis, who gave such a festive feeling to the opening hours of registration, to the Chinese lion dancers, and we decorated the dining room for a Chinese feast. That was really fun. And several of our international students were a part of that design as well. It's traditional here in the doctoral program that when students complete their coursework, they might not have the dissertation done, but the coursework is done, they are celebrated with a bagpiper who leads them out of the auditorium where they've been taking classes for 3 years and acknowledge as sixth semester students who have finished their coursework. So when we transitioned from the University of La Verne as host to New Mexico State as the 1999 host, we used a bagpiper to lead everyone to lunch and away from that closing mm-hmm. ceremony to build on our own La Verne tradition. Fun. And this is a group that does know how to have fun.
Mm-hmm.
They know how to play mm-hmm. and they know how to work. And
mm-hmm.
you see evidence of that, for instance, in the tradition of the Friday evening talent show, where people's talents as musicians or comedians or storytellers are expressed in ways that you know must spill over into the creativity of their classrooms.
Study looked just like all the other diversity studies. So I thought, okay, yeah, this isn't working out.
There's so much joy in that talent show. And it's matched by the gathering, the social gathering every evening of Jim's Place, which acknowledges mm-hmm. one of the founding members of the Organization on Behavior Teaching Society in his memory, with the singing around the piano and the chance to just mix and network and socialize. I'm glad we can make that happen as well for this year's conference. This really is the first year, I think, that we have begun to acknowledge that the Organizational Behavior Teaching Society is really growing up. If you're 25 years old, you're moving into a different stage of your organizational life cycle. So we gathered a number of programs from previous years, t-shirts, and caps, and other souvenirs from previous years, and set up a history exhibit upstairs here in Miller Hall. And that was fun. It was just a small start, but the board of the society is very much aware of this, and we'll be asking members to contribute more things so that we can develop an archive. And the 50th anniversary will have a very splendid historical exhibit.
I actually thought there was a lot of stuff up there, which just, those were items that were donated from members.
Yeah,
loan. Excuse me. Yes.
Chris Paulson is already calling right, to say, right. Where's my stuff?
And look how much they keep.
Yes. Oh, yes. They keep their t-shirts from every year. And as the world of business and management and the teaching of business and management have changed, we in the universities have become more international to match the globalness of the people whom we teach and who go out in the world to work and conduct their professional lives. So the society does have an international conference. It was in Cape Town, South Africa this last year, and it will be in Milano, Italy next year. And there also are a number of people who come from campuses on other continents to what is called, our conference was called, the North American Conference. So I don't know, do we remember? The Czech Republic, Italy, South Africa, Australia,
New Zealand,
mm-hmm. Brunei, England,
Czech United Republic,
Kingdom, mm-hmm. Bulgaria. That is traditionally done in the program every year is a listing of which of our colleagues in the society have been honored by their home universities for excellence in teaching or outstanding educator of the year, whatever the award would be on that particular campus. And the traditional Friday evening award ceremony also pays attention to excellence in scholarship because the outstanding article in the Journal of Management Education is identified each year, and the authors of the article are honored. And the award ceremony is also time to acknowledge board members who are leaving the board and recognize those who have been newly
right.
elected. Mm-hmm. So it's part of the structure and stability of the organization's life to pay this kind of recognition and to notice the passage and the change as people take different roles. It's a thoughtful part of Friday evening.
Different ways of honoring and celebrating and appreciating our diverse membership. The first one being the OBTS Distinguished Educator Award, the purpose and the criteria is there, the requirements, the deadlines for you to follow. We encourage you to think about nominating yourself, asking someone to nominate you, or however you want to get this, share this with your colleagues, your deans, your chairs, so that you can be nominated.
It is really great to see that people go to this type of work, that belong to this type of organization, to really improve themselves, to gather information, and then they are acknowledged with awards for that. I mean, that's
and
people
recognized
that continue
by
to
their
try to
promise.
Get better. I
yes.
think that's so great.
Yeah.
These are teachers who are learners.
Right.
Right.
I think
right.
it's important that the emphasis on teaching and the excellence in teaching.
Yeah. And it's part of our joy in interacting with these people. Because I kept telling everybody, you're going to love these people when they come on campus. For 2 years, I would walk across this campus and see them clustered under the trees out here, or sitting at that picnic table right outside Wilson Library. I could just picture this campus flooded with these people. Are the finest of professional colleagues.
Sometimes we find our ways in the shadows of our pain, thinking by the rainbows as we walk through the rain. And we smile within our sorrows, laughing instead of shouting. Try to make the best of things somehow. It all works out. Or still we keep on dreaming and we try to get it right. But sometimes you got to lose when you fight the noble fight. Try to make the best.